The hardest part of El Niño forecasting is probably the uncertainty that's due to all the other factors that are going on at the same time.
ENSO.
Tropical Pacific Ocean. Basically, ENSO is that cycle between El Niño and La Niña.
ENSO stands for the El Niño-Southern Oscillation, and it is what we call a coupled climate mode.
For ENSO, that coupling is between the slow-moving ocean and faster-moving atmosphere.
One of the reasons that it's important for ENSO to couple is that's why it lasts so long.
Because it lasts so long, ENSO has far-reaching effects across the world.
El Niño es un fenómeno de escala global, pero cuyos impactos son a escala local.
And lots of impacts upon Australia during El Niño and La Niña. So it really is a time that offers a lot of threats to both public safety and also our farming communities as well.
Afecta la seguridad alimentaria por diferentes maneras. Pierdes absolutamente todo. No tienes cómo llegar a las personas a llevar lo que tienes que llevar. No hay cómo, no, y se pierden las vías de acceso.
So before we go too far, let's talk a little bit about how ENSO actually works. Normally, or under normal conditions, the western tropical Pacific is warmer than in the eastern Pacific, which creates a gradient of high pressure in the east and low pressure in the west. This whole cycle, it's called the Walker circulation, describing how these equatorial winds flow from the high pressure down to the low pressure.
So the sea surface temperature along the equatorial Pacific and the temperature below the surface. That's where the memory or the inertia of the whole system lies.
And those subsurface temperatures can be shifted by things called Kelvin waves.
La frecuencia e intensidad de las ondas de Kelvin, que son los que, bueno, digamos, son los que transportan esta masa cálida.
A Kelvin wave travels from west to east along the equator below the surface of the water, pushing down the separation between cool deep water and warmer surface water, bringing warmer surface temperatures into the east.
On occasion, it is weather or this, you know, subseasonal phenomenon that caused the winds that essentially kick off, you know, an oceanic Kelvin wave, which then can result in El Niño.
So for example, if you have an El Niño event, and you've got warm anomalies in the eastern Pacific and that weakened Walker circulation, that's allowing heat content to be lost, effectively subsurface cold anomalies in the western Pacific.
And to reverse it?
If there's enough energy left in that subsurface signal after that current event has gone, it can come to the surface and be the trigger for the next positive feedback into a La Niña event.
In a La Niña event, the temperature of the eastern Pacific decreases compared to normal, strengthening the Walker circulation. So we know what's actually happening, but how did we figure this all out in the first place?
The real game changer was this very simple model that Mark Kane and Steve Zebiak developed in the 1980s.
The work was not particularly well accepted initially.
There were some tough months in there when we were, you know, our forecast was going up and the world was not.
And this was definitely a breakthrough in forecasting. We had a working model, but it was really simple, and eventually a model that simple could be wrong. Since then, a ton of work has gone into the different types of models and forecasting.
The development right now with respect to ENSO is on the models, particularly improving the dynamical models.
Okay, so there are two main types of models climate scientists use to predict ENSO. Statistical models that use all the historical information we've got about ENSO to predict what'll happen in the future. And dynamical models that are based on what we know about the physics of the Earth.
These are global climate circulation models that are run on big supercomputers, and they ingest tons of data from satellites and buoys and various other locations to try and essentially initialize a model and then run it forward using physical equations and our understanding of the atmosphere.
Until recently, though, those dynamical models weren't as good as the statistical models.
The advantage of those is that they're a lot faster to run. The characteristic shape of ENSO events will be captured. The disadvantage is it's very hard for them to distinguish one type of event from another type of event, to get that inter-event variability.
The dynamical models, even some of the statistical models now, are better than they've ever been. And really, I think we have to trust them a lot more these days.
Though the models are improving, there are still a lot of challenges with making an accurate prediction. And that starts with getting good data.
To do a prediction, you have to say something about what is the initial state of the system that you're then trying to forecast the subsequent evolution of.
That depends on what the background state is, by which we just mean the climatological state that varies over the course of the year from spring to summer to fall to winter. If you don't get that right, then you're not going to get the predictions exactly right.
A good model needs to know the conditions of the atmosphere, like how surface winds are moving and how much rain there is in the equatorial Pacific. And it needs to have good information on the temperature across the ocean. But sometimes, even that isn't enough.
There can be some debate over how predictable is ENSO really.
Certainly one of the limitations in the predictability is the sensitivity to initial conditions. It's also referred to as chaos. And with respect to something like an El Nino forecast or seasonal forecast, when you're looking out that far, chaos can just refer to the weather.
And because of that, it is hard to tell how much more forecasting can still improve.
For the last 10 years, there has been very little improvement in the prediction models. It's possible we can get a little bit better, but we believe there's an inherent predictability limit, and we may be near that limit.
This gets especially muddied when we start to ask what is going to happen to ENSO as the climate changes.
It may be that global warming is changing the background state in such a way as to change the character of ENSO, so where it's going to peak.
I think we are reliant on the models to some extent to understand whether climate change will impact ENSO. But when you're in the model world, you better also have some very good physical mechanisms to explain why El Niños and La Niñas would become more frequent.
It's very debatable whether it will start having a systematic effect on the behavior of ENSO. Some models say yes, some models say not much.
And one of the concerns I have is that climate change could impact ENSO, but it would take us, you know, 100 years, 200 years to actually, in the observations, see that.
What we can say, though, is that some of the regional climate impacts may be altered because of climate change. So in particular, places that tend to get warm or places that tend to have drought, that could be exacerbated by a warmer climate.
And that's a legitimate worry because ENSO has real, sometimes dangerous effects all over the world.
You can get all this rearranging heating out of an El Nino event for the atmosphere, and that affects everything all over the globe. We have a jargon word, teleconnection, which only means that things are connected over a large region.
And for ENSO, those connections lead to a cascade of global impacts.
Southern Africa.
Drier conditions.
For Peru,
widespread flooding.
Wetter than average conditions in parts of the Horn of Africa.
The differences in the impact can be very, very strong depending on the patterns and the timing of the events.
At the heart of the story of ENSO prediction is finding ways to help society prepare.
We try to uncover and sort of tease out what is weather and what is climate.
You learn that ENSO affects the climate. Therefore, I must be interested in ENSO in order to be interested in seeing what governs the climate.
Because what governs the climate governs fundamental aspects of our everyday lives.